the seminar on the occasion of the launching of the book, Healthcare Reforms in India, by Sri Rajan Prasad Gupta. And on this occasion, I am very privileged to share the dais with the very innovative, suggestive, bringing us the concept of Narayan Health, Sri Devi Shetty ji, Sri Hughes ji, Sri Sripad Nayak ji, Sri Rajan Prasad Gupta ji, and the distinguished gathering assembled in this house this evening. Now, I am not a medical practitioner. Sometimes this doctor gives a very confusing status to me. Long back, my mother constructed a small house in Eastern Delhi. And out of love for me, she placed my nameplate, Dr. Murli Manohar Joshi. The people from the locality started coming to me, ki mere bacche ko ye ho gaya, isko zukam ho gaya, isko ye ho gaya. Then I had to tell them I am not a medical doctor. Therefore, now I find to give me a special category of doctor professor. And professor is in the bracket. But all over my life, I was professor out of the bracket. I've taught 40 years in a university. There's something very strange which I find. To me, professor is superior to a doctor in all respects. So I don't want to be encaged. I want to be free. Anyway, strange are the ways of seminars. In the age of technology, you don't know when you are caged and when you are out of cage. Well, I'm very, very happy and in full agreement with Dr. Shetty when he says that the immediate policy and goal of India's healthcare should be its separation from affluence. This is the Indian goal. And I am very happy he has also given us another slogan: to avoid the need of FDI in medicine. But I think I fully agree with it, because I have been pleading for a number of years to avoid FDI in almost all sections. India is full of resources. The only thing is we don't know how to harness it. This is the tragedy of our country. People have been saying a healthy economy will make a healthy nation. I sincerely beg to differ. It is a healthy nation which makes a healthy economy. The healthcare does not start after the birth or after the arrival of a disease. In my opinion, it starts pre-birth, prenatal. It starts right from the health of an adolescent girl. If she's not healthy, if she's anemic, if she suffers from micronutrient deficiencies, she can never deliver a healthy child. It is a healthy mother which delivers a healthy child. And healthy mother means that the adolescent girl must be taken care of. As a minister, I had the charge of several ministries, then rolled into one known as Human Resource Development Ministry. I was in charge of Women and Child Department also, within Human Resource Development. I think it is the right approach. Now it has been separated, I don't know why. Because the arrival of a human being is the beginning to think about what type of resource you are going to make out of it. So the most important point in India's healthcare is to take care of adolescent girls. Then it comes to the care of the children, their nutrition, and their education. No nation can flourish without investment in food and education and health. Agriculture, education, health. These are the three most important pillars to sustain a healthy democracy, a useful democracy, a nation which will work not only for its own population, but will be able to serve humanity at large. As a minister, I had an opportunity to go into these questions a little deeper. So starting a scheme to take care of these girls, mothers, pregnant mothers, and then came the child, and then the education of the child. So I changed the constitution. I gave the fundamental right to all children between 6 to 14 of free and compulsory education. But we are not implementing it in the spirit in which the constitution was changed. Unless the education is common, unless the education is without any discrimination, if it creates a sense of oneness and unity, then of course the nation's health can be taken care of without any, I may say, strife or turbulence or conflicts. So the most important factors are to give a cool and careful thought about the concepts and the goals. Mr. Hughes talked about science, technology, and health. Now, I have been a student of science, physics. Now, this science in the Western world started in its real form after the Renaissance, between the 16th and 17th centuries. But what happened? The initial formulation of scientific thought was given by Descartes, René Descartes, the French philosopher, mathematician, supported by Newton, Galileo, Bacon. They gave us wonderful results, wonderful laws. Most of the health technology is derived from the laws of physics. Almost human body works on the laws of physics. So I can say with some, if not authority, but at least with some impunity, that we as scientists have created some problems for you also. Because Descartes' philosophy was, I exist because I think. Cogito ergo sum. Therefore, I am a thinking personality. My thought process and the instrument which gives me thought process, that is my brain, my mind, is superior to my body. So a mind-body dichotomy started. Mind is different from body. Mind controls the body. I am a thinking person. Nature is inert, dead, without any mind. Therefore, I control the nature. Now, this entire philosophy resulted in a very strange concept about universe. One of our Nobel laureates once, while discussing with us, said, Dr. Joshi, I believe the whole problem in science today has arisen because of cosmology. The worldview, how do you look at the universe? Whether universe is a whole or it is a combination of its parts. Whether parts are superior or whole is superior. This so-called modern medicine depends upon this Western thought, which we call as reductionism in science, that you want to reduce everything to know its final reality. If you want to know the universe, reduce it into galaxies. Want to know the galaxies, reduce into the solar system. Want to reduce into the planetary bodies. Want to understand your own planet? Try to reduce it. How it is composed? What makes it a planet? Then you reach the atoms. So in the beginning of 19th century, these were the problems which were confronting these scientists. Then in the beginning of the 20th century, suddenly we found, oh, we have reached the atom. And most of the scientists say this is the end of the story now, we have got the final reality. After some years, we found, no, there are subatomic particles. And there comes the real problem. And that is the problem of the entire Western system of medicine. In order to understand human body, you also started to disintegrate into it. How do you want to understand it? If you want to understand this, cut it, see it. You want to understand your eyes, how do you understand? Want to understand your heart? Yes, it is a pump. Your eyes, they are a camera. Your kidneys, they are a filter. Your hands, they are liver. Your movements of your fingers, they give you an idea of a sort of a robot. And now you see the results have been fantastic. I go to a clinic, consult my doctor, he says you have a retinal defect or what you call this cataract. I go to another doctor, in 10 minutes I'm out. A garage for eyes is just on the board. I went to a doctor, I got my knee transplanted. I come here, I have one transplant, the other I'm waiting for. This is technology, you see. But if I ask him, ki, what makes my bones sick? He has no answer to it. The great Nobel laureate Francis Crick said, after 60 years of research, we do not know how a single cell or a group of cells which has been damaged by a cut reproduces itself in the original form. No answer. Microbiologists try to understand diseases on this basis. They produced medicines on that basis. Does it give us any circuit? No. It helps us in certain deformities. And who creates those deformities? They were not given us right from the birth. These deformities are the deformities of the civilization. Deformities of the technology. My friend has a deformity of the technology. He has a shoulder. I told him. No, science and technology are very good. I can't say they are bad because I have been teaching them. But they have the flip side of it. And that we should not ignore. That flip side should make us thoughtful why this misunderstanding about our own self. If I ask a medical practitioner, how do you define a human being? Is it a composition created out of different parts? One thing came here, one joint, bolt, and here is a human personality? No. Right from the beginning, Descartes said, I am a thinking person. Now, to all the leading doctors here, I say, what makes my brain work as a mind? Be mindful. The basic question in physics we used to raise, what is matter? Never mind. What is mind does not matter. All psychosomatic diseases are out of range. No. Because mind is something totally different. And there is no place for mind in a body. That is something. Now, these are the problems which have to be understood in the first in the philosophical plane, on the conceptual plane. How do you define a human body? How do you define health? There is a WHO definition for it. It has to be in complete harmony with your, when you say health, body and what? Functionings of the body, they are there. But is it a relationship between body and mind or not? That does not occur in the definition of health. It is only the Ayurvedic system or the ancient Indian system which defines a perfect human personality. Up till now, to my understanding, it is that human body, human persona, is a body, an intellect, a mind, and a soul or a psyche, however you might. If all of them are in harmony, if all of them feel a sense of unity and oneness, you are in health. Because the concept in ancient Indian system of health is swastha. Aap swastha hai, ye puna. What is this swastha? That is, you are ensconced in yourself. Oh, what is this self? What is this self? The English health, something is to be healed. It comes from healing. So there must be something which is diseased, unhealthy. So unhealthy state of affairs is the precondition for the health care of the modern system. So we do create unhealthy situations by the civilization, the type of technology, the mad race for affluence, which I fully agree should be separated from healthcare. So these are the basic things which we must try to resolve in order to create a healthy human being and a system to make it. It is one thing to cure, and it is one thing to keep you healthy. Curative and formative. Your whole system is so formed that you cannot be unhealthy. The system must be a system which produces healthy human beings. Now this, you see that this basic contradictions which have arisen, and this rejection of one system by the other, that is also incorrect. Few Ayurvedic people will reject the entire development in medical science. No, that's wrong. And some of the, or rather most of the medical, modern medical students will reject the Ayurvedic system. This is absolutely wrong. You must integrate the two. You must. Otherwise, it will be impossible to create a real health care system, because one defines the health, the other gives you a little bit more facilities to take care of certain deformities which may be the creation of the system itself, but they need a cure. And this cure should not be costly. I fully agree, I endorse him for that. I would say that he should be given a highest prize for coining this sort of a slogan. I do fully. This is the spirit of India, you see. This is the spirit of India. This is the, when he said Narayan health, I immediately said Narayan health. Because what he has given you a slogan, I don't know whether you appreciated its inner meaning or not. We see, and there is a very famous slogan which we generally call Nar Seva, Narayan Seva. It's now in the reverse. That he brings Narayan to Sevadi, to serve the Nar. But the basic thing is that Narayan Seva means to serve the divinity in every human being. Now this divinity does not arise from the reductionist approach. This divinity arises from the holistic approach. Therefore, healthcare is not a very simple subject. It is a very vast, complex, and I may say, very human subject. It is the service of humanity to produce the most healthy human society. And for that, you see, again there is a dichotomy between ourselves and nature. So we, because we think we are superior, so we have an authority to pollute the nature, to denigrate it, to exploit it, because I'm. And that Mr. Francis Bacon said, that I will torture this nature to reveal its secrets. You will take third degree method, CBI wale karte hain ki. We'll torture them too. So that system, we are trying to torture the nature. And nature is very clever, you see. It recoils all that torture on us. Supreme Court says, as if we are living with a society with a mask. Who has given this mask? Who has given this pollution? Nature was not polluted right from the beginning. We created pollution. We developed an economic system and a technological system which created the diseases of the society, or civilization as I call. We created an unequal economic system. We created healthcare as a business. The other day, Rajan brought me a journal. And as soon as I opened it, the page said, you see, healthcare in India has a $65 billion business. Wonderful. When I was reading all those celebrations of International Yoga Day, again, news comes, yoga is wonderful. There is $35 billion business of yoga in. There is yoga juice, there is yoga dress. So, if you take up healthcare or yoga as business, as commodities, as medical commodities, well, certainly you can earn money, but you can't live in healthcare. That is the most important. Now, I will congratulate Rajiv for not writing all this in this book, huh? Because if you would have written this book, elsewhere would not have published it. Because then it would not have brought a single dollar to them. Because for you, this book is not only an awareness about Indians' policies and their defaults, but is also a business. Let's be honest about that. So that way, you see, he has written something about which Dr. Shetty has pointed out. But I congratulate him for one thing, that he has quoted extensively from some of my reports. I had examined in depth the National Rural Health Mission of this country. And several ministers, office bearers, officers, secretaries are in jail. There was a more than a 10,000 crore scam in that. And again, one of my students whom I taught physics was in jail because he was involved in that scam. So the question is, National Rural Health Mission, which was to take care of the health problems of rural area, was reduced to a big hoax. The primary health centers were neither primary nor health nor centers. Some of them were being used as entertainment centers, playing cards, drinking alcohol, and whatnot. In some, we have found cow dung was stored. The others, the public distribution shops were open, so there was neither primary nor health nor center. It is this which we have to take care of, you see, if it is a primary health center. Who will go there? It's a very valid question which is raised. Nobody would go there. Even if there is a dedicated person, he goes there, there is no road, he has to cycle. There is no electricity, especially in most of the UP, Bihar and this area, parts of Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan. You will find it. If he has a family, where to put them? If he has children, where to educate them? So again, it is an integrated problem. It is a related, it is a systemic problem. You have educated a person as a doctor, by whose father has paid some 25 lakhs to get him an admission. This is the stark reality. Do you expect him to go and serve there? He would immediately like to go to an institution or open his own nursing home to at least recover 50 lakhs or a crore. Why should you go there? Why? You create a system which has no relevance with this country's practical situation, and then you ask that fellow to go there. Thank you. So that is the problem. You see, this has to be understood and realized. No reform will be possible unless you take care of the ground situation. It's true, which Dr. Shetty has said, that high specialists are not needed. Why? As a minister, when I said, I started just a 5 rupee dadi amma, dadi ka batwa to be given to Anganwadi workers. It had almost all necessary prophylactics or even curatives for infant diseases. Indian indigenous system or Ayurvedic system has almost cure of these elementary diseases within the home. All your spices are medicines. There was a flatulence, the dadi amma would come, will just rub a little bit of hing, apply on its navel, and the flatulence is gone. Now the modern man says, give me a trial. First try on this what you call mouse, then you try on monkeys. But the flatulence is in my tummy, it's not in the tummy of the mouse. Then after having tried on them, then you try on me. You have your own system, you produce poisons, I understand it. Therefore you have to try. Your clinical trials are a must. You create antibodies or antibiotics which are not present in the human system. You introduce them. Therefore, you have to create a situation and convince me, Baba, this is not poisonous. This is not harmful. Whether it is, or I don't know, because the certification process, as I know about it, is also not very honest. I can say it with authority. What is happening in the immunization program, I know it. The book has mentioned it. I congratulate him for it. As a minister and in charge of UNESCO, as a culture minister, I was invited to address certain meetings in UNESCO. Well, there comes a WHO officer, puts before me a small request that, sir, we are going to launch a new oral rehydration pouch. Will you please launch it? Manika, yes. I asked them, what does it contain? It has glucose, it is salt, and it is vitamin C. I said, wonderful, this is the latest. This was known to an ordinary grandma of our villages since millennia. When I was a young kid, my grandmother would say, you are going out in summer, it's hot wind outside, take this glass of water, add a pinch of salt, squeeze a little lemon, drop a little, one or two pieces of mishri or some one spoon of sugar, stir it, drink it, and be happy. I never suffered from a what? Sunstroke or a dehydration. Then I told them that I am very happy that you have ultimately recognized this millennium-old, the so-called folk medicine, but it is the same. What you have done is, you have made glucose. Fine. The profit goes to a glucose manufacturing company. Profit goes to a vitamin C manufacturing company. If you distribute it all over this country, you have gained nothing, but you have lost something. So the healthcare, or all these things have to be integrated completely with our knowledge. This year, the Nobel Prize on Medicine goes to a Chinese lady doctor. On what? On finding out a treatment for malaria. From what? From a drug. Made of? From a herb. Neem. You have an abundance. Then you start cutting neem trees in all over the country and then say, we are now chasing the mosquitoes. I mean, the nature has already given you an anti-malarial prophylactic. Why? You must first understand your country, your conditions, your geographical conditions, your agroclimatic zones, your food habits. Just a week back, I read a small report, but that is very significant. Dr. Vijay Lakshmi, who was here in Manesar, our brain research center, which incidentally I created during my ministry, the brain research center. She has now gone to Bangalore. After retirement, she is working as a special professor there. She has tried on ashwagandha. And she says that initial researches show that it reverses the loss of memory. It brings back memory. Now, ashwagandha is known to us right from the beginning of Ayurveda. Now, because she has tried on a mice, and then I asked her, are you going to try on a monkey? Then you will try on me. I'm taking it already. Now, this, you should prove it through that method. 1,000 years of application of that medicine to a human system has not produced any body as a lunatic or a Alzheimer patient. Never. It might not have been brought back the memory to the old standards or of your young days memory, but it has not created Alzheimer. Another my student who is working in America as a nanophysicist, he has tried to isolate the nanoparticle from turmeric, curcumin. And he says that the curcumin is the only thing which cures Alzheimer. And he is now trying to create a system through which the brain barrier is crossed and curcumin reaches the brain. So this is, you are taking haldi every day, at least once in the sambar in the morning or nashta in the morning, then in your lunch, then in your dinner. You know it. Institution in England, who are trying now to create a system in Chennai to validate many of these Ayurvedic formulations and to create nanoparticles out of them. And that will be the real history, that will be the real innovation, that will be the real contribution towards a very affordable, accessible, and effective healthcare system. You have to do like that. I have also warned them that please don't make it into that it is a business because you are coming here in India with a huge population. Make it that it is for the service of mankind, for making humanity as healthy. In India, during Ashoka's time, hospitals were free. Anybody could walk, get treated, and go out. Right in 18th century, one of the Chhatradipatis in Tamil Nadu wrote to the residents. Resident was brought from England on them. about the working of this, their chakra, and he said, anybody who comes here, whether he's an orphan or not an orphan, but if he wants to join this chakra, he's welcome. We teach them, we feed them, and if they get any disease, we treat them, and we don't charge anything. This is the concept of Indian health care. Indian health care is the duty of society and state combined. In my childhood, these Ayurved people, the Marwadi Dharmshala, Marwadi Oshdhale, that Oshdhale, this Oshdhale, and they were free. This is the duty of the state, and I repeat it as a member of parliament also, and as a minister I have also said it. The health care, the education and feeding, these three things are the duties of a welfare state. They are our fundamental right. And to transfer it on this or that, I don't think is in my opinion, a very healthy concept. This is one of the most important difference between some of the Western countries and ourselves. Some of the Western countries have taken this. This is like Cuba, for example. See their healthcare system. There are countries which say, you know, education and this social security is the duty of the state to create a healthy human being. But what we are doing, no primary, no secondary, immediately we go to the tertiary, medical college, 10,000 vacancy, seats bada denge. Kahan jayenge wo? Hospital. Hospital kahan hoga? Bade shahar. Bimar kahan hai? Gaon. This separation is not good. This policy reform has to be done. That apart, other things, there are so many things which he has pointed out in this book, that they very, very assiduously, very meticulously, thorough research. They are there and they should be taken care of. But these fundamental things have to be taken care of. So Rajendra has been working very hard. I have seen him working. His language is perfectly scientific in this, methodical. And it is, I think, such a reference book that a small edition after every 2-3 years will keep it of a permanent nature. This is up to 2013. So up next year you can have 4 pages and send it to your readers. 4 pages are available for a small cost. Yeah. So this you can make, I am suggesting you a business technique also, although. Yeah. But you see, because that is for him, he's not a healthcare man, he's a publisher. So he has to care for the health of his publishing institution also. Na? Yeah. So anyway, I must say that there's a lot to be said and a lot to be understood. I again say one thing, the Ayurveda, sometimes people feel, I've seen that somewhere, I've seen somewhere here or here, if a system is static, it will not remain in the race. Ayurveda is very, very dynamic. When syphilis was brought to India, by whom? By Portuguese. Portuguese were known as Ferengis. Portuguese were the first to enter India and first to introduce syphilis. Within 9 years at that time, 300 years ago, within 9 years, there was no modern system of medicines then. They identified the disease, they found out its source, they provided its treatment, and the treatment is valid even today, the arsenic compound. Salvars and the new salvars. Just 4-5 years ago, another CSIR Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award winner, proved the validity of vata, pitta and kapha, the prakriti, by simulations through the most modern, most sensitive instruments. And today you can, after the age of 5, decide by the genomic study that this gentleman or this boy is prone to which diseases and how it can be therefore immediately cured. But that will affect the business of pharma companies, because in this case the medicine will be a customized medicine. It cannot be a general dose with a particular body weight given to everybody, whether it is in Africa or whether it is in Timbuktu or in Tundra. But this system, it justifies that your prakriti is different from my prakriti. My medicine will be different from your medicine. It is such a scientific system. And those Karolinska Institute people are not fools. They are coming here to understand. And for validation, Dr. Velyathan, I gave him a project, and I think it is still continuing, the validation of all the Ayurvedic formulae, all the Ayurvedic combinations. So this knowledge must be integrated with what we have developed in past 300 years. So from 3,000 years, add this 300 years and make a better system. That I can understand. So another policy decision should be to have an integrated medical education. No system is wrong. Every system has limitations. So those limitations can be removed, can be extended by integrating it with our system. Ayurveda has its own limitations. So has modern medicine its own limitations. In some cases, homeopathy works wonderfully. Why should we discard it? Yunani works very well. So an integrated education policy, a medical education, and then anybody can choose. You can then decide for this work, this qualification, for this work, this qualification. But don't have an umbrella board ki ye hi karna hai. That way I think this book will serve some very long time usefulness for all those who are interested in improving India's healthcare system, provided we do care for nation's health. I tell you, one unhealthy person at the age of 10, if he becomes disabled or mentally, retarded, what will happen? For 50, 60 years, the nation will have to spend for it. He will never become an economic actor. So the health of a nation's economy depends upon the mental and physical health of the people. I must congratulate again Rajendra and the publisher and Dr. Devi Shetty for his wonderful talk and with great, I may say, clarity, which he has given certain suggestions, and our Sripad Nayak's, I may say, fervent appeal for promoting Ayurveda and Yoga. Thank you very much.